Hi, everybody. This is Joe Chaffin. I'd like to welcome you to the Bud Bank Guy podcast for November 2012. Today, we're going to be doing part one of a two-part podcast on transfusion reactions. Specifically, today, we'll be going over the workup, the basic things that every laboratory should do both in the lab and at the bedside when confronted with a suspected transfusion reaction. In December, next month, we will actually cover the specifics of the individual transfusion reactions. I just want to thank you for being here very much. I very much appreciate you taking the time, and I will do my best to give you some good information and stuff that you can use on a day-to-day basis. So with no further ado, let's get going. I always think it's very important before we get into the specifics of the workup to give you the why. Why do we care about this? Why do we actually get involved in doing transfusion reaction workups? And the reason for me is really simple. If you take a look at this slide, which is the transfusion fatalities reported to the FDA between 2007 and 2011, you can see, if you just look at the general breakdown here, that you have things like trally, hemolytic transfusion reactions and infections, etc. The bottom line for this should be really clear to you is that transfusions still have the potential to harm people. They don't harm people in the way that we used to think of people getting harmed, such as people getting HIV or people getting hepatitis C, for example. We actually can see that transfusion reactions cause significantly more fatalities than anything else. So it's important for us to recognize these things and be able to manage these things. And the transfusion reaction workup, which is our topic for today, is hugely important in us getting a good start on that. So who needs to know how to do these things? Why is this something that I'm talking about? Well, really, anyone involved in transfusion, from ordering doctors, consulting doctors, transfusing nurses and perfusionists, certainly blood bank workers, and absolutely pathologists and pathology residents, need to have a really good idea of how transfusion reactions present, and when they do present, what to do about them. And all that starts with the basics of the transfusion reaction workup, again, our topic for today. So, what should trigger a transfusion reaction workup? Very important to keep a really good idea on this. And I break these down into a couple of different categories. The first four on this slide are generally inflammatory changes, such as fever. Fever is hugely important. The presence or absence of a temperature increase can help us not only categorize our reactions, but often is somewhat indicative of how severe the reaction is going to be. Patients that have chills, or like this poor man on the right side of the slide, or unfortunately, those who have rigors. Rigors, now please remember, rigors is a little bit different from chills. Rigors are true, honest to God, shaking, the bed is rattling type chills. You'll see overlap in some of the references. I tend to keep those somewhat separate, though. Those other people lump them together. Skin changes, pain, especially pain at the infusion site, all those are inflammatory type changes. Circulatory changes, on the other hand, include things like changes in blood pressure, patient who goes into shock, and patients with hemoglobinemia and hemoglobinuria that we'll talk about in just a little while. Pulmonary or respiratory issues can present in a wide variety of transfusion reactions, including actually acute hemolytic reactions that can present with some mild wheezing because of inflammatory cytokines that are generated. But more commonly, you see them, the pulmonary issues, with things like transfusion-associated circulatory overload or transfusion-related acute lung injury. And they can just range from shortness of breath all the way up to full pulmonary failure. Coagulation and bleeding issues can be a really big deal in patients who are anesthetized. That may be the first sign or symptom of a hemolytic transfusion reaction is the presence of someone who suddenly has uncontrolled bleeding while they're in the operating room. Anesthesiologists are very alert and aware to this, but I think that we in the laboratory have less of a tendency to recognize that as a potential presenting sign or symptom of a transfusion reaction. So patients can go into DIC with acute hemolytic reactions as well. More on that in the next lecture. So the last one is kind of my favorite because it still does make me laugh a little bit, and that's the psychological issues. People can present with weird mental status changes, including one that I always laugh when I read it because it just sounds like it can't possibly be serious. Someone who presents with a sense of impending doom, doom, doom. I hope I didn't scare you with that, but I have to say it that way because it makes me laugh. Obviously, it's not a laughing matter, but patients have been reported with acute hemolytic reactions to have this sudden ongoing sense of impending doom, which really does sound frightening, doesn't it? Okay, I mentioned the temperature increase is very important. Actually, I use the temperature increase, the presence or absence of a fever, along with the timing of the reaction, to classify transfusion reactions. And this is what we will hang all of this stuff that we're doing in the workup on when we go into the specific reactions the next time. So an increase in temperature is very important, and when combined with timing, you can actually get yourself a nice little grid. I like the way this breaks down, and I've been using this for years. Basically, if you look at the top part of this grid here, you'll see that these are the reactions that typically present with a temperature increase, with a fever. Things like acute hemolytic reactions and febrile, obviously, non-hemolytic reactions, sepsis, trally, delayed hemolytic reactions, and transfusion-associated graft-versus-host disease. Those tend to be the most severe reactions that we see in general, not always certainly, and the ones on the bottom are those that present without a temperature increase, typically, not always, but typically. And the allergic reactions and TACO and delayed serologic post-transfusion purpura, etc., typically don't present with any kind of a temperature increase. On the other hand, you can also divide these from left to right with the acute reactions versus the delayed reactions. Acute reactions, by definition, occur either during the transfusion or within the first 24 hours after the transfusion, and they include some of the big ones like acute hemolytic reactions and trally, etc., including the ones on the bottom. This allergic, both mild and severe reactions. On the left side, you have the delayed reactions. By definition, they occur more than 24 hours after the transfusion, and sometimes up to several weeks after the transfusion. And the two biggest ones are, of course, the ones at the top, the delayed hemolytic reaction and transfusion-associated GVHD. Again, we will use this framework to define transfusion reactions when we talk about the specifics in the next chapter, but we will, in the next podcast, I should say, but we will also reference this when we're talking about some of the things that we talk about today. In particular, we're primarily, though, going to be talking about the acute hemolytic reaction, and there's a really good reason for that. That comes down to some of my general philosophies of transfusion reaction workup. In particular, opinion one, and this is my opinion, is that when something weird happens during a transfusion, I always assume acute hemolysis. I assume that this patient is having an acute hemolytic reaction, and I work to prove myself wrong. I do that for a specific reason. I don't want to miss one of these. And I think that if you have a very high index of suspicion, you're much less likely to ignore them. My opinion, too, is a little bit more controversial. I'll just tell you that right up front. And it's that I believe that everyone involved should be able to start the process of a reaction workup. And that specifically means that nurses and other transfusing personnel should be able to contact the blood bank directly, regardless of what the ordering physician says, and actually start that process. Now, clinicians, if you're listening to this, you may not like that, but I will tell you that I've seen all too many cases where a nurse or another person doing the transfusion says something is wrong here, and a doctor says, it's just another one of those boring febrile reactions. Just go ahead and give them some Tylenol and plow through it. Now, please, I'm not naive, so I certainly recognize that in patients who are having recurrent spiking fevers, it can be really tough and it can get frustrating. Another fever, what do I do with this? But I would really caution you against that kind of an attitude. It really is dangerous. All temperature elevations should be taken seriously, and I would far rather work up a multitude of negative reactions than miss the one that actually is a significant transfusion reaction. And I've had the unfortunate experience of actually seeing that happen. So when that happens, I can tell you it changes you a little bit. Okay, so what's this process we've been talking about? The process for me is fairly straightforward. I break them down into several tiers. The first tier, or tier one as I like to call it, is the basic thing that really every laboratory should do when confronted with a potential transfusion reaction. They include the things that you see up there at the top of the box, and then the tier two things are things that you go to only if there's something suspicious on the tier one workup. So let's talk first about tier one, and the first step of tier one is the same every single time, and that's stop the transfusion. Remember, I'm assuming acute hemolysis when these things happen. And if I know, point three there, that the amount of incompatible blood is predictive in an acute hemolytic reaction of how well or how poorly the patient's going to do, then the first thing I'm going to ask every time is, has the transfusion been stopped? And I would really recommend that you make that your first question, whether you're a doctor hearing about this from your nurse on the ward, whether you're a blood bank tech hearing about this, whether you're a pathologist or a pathology resident, and really, even if you're a nurse talking to another nurse, if something weird happens during a transfusion, first at least stop that flow of blood. Make sure that you keep IV access open. You don't have to pull everything, but at least stop the flow of incompatible blood, and you'll be doing your patient a favor. Step two of the tier one workup is to perform a clerical check, and that's just simply to look at all the paperwork, both at the bedside and in the transfusion service in the blood bank, to see that this was really the right unit that was intended to go to this patient. Now, sometimes you see weird things on clerical checks, and I like to show this one because it makes me laugh. This was from a place that I worked in Northern Colorado not long after I got out of the Army in the late 90s. I worked there for 11 years. I love these people, and I love this hospital, so please don't think that I'm saying anything bad about them. I'm not. This is just great. We had a suspected transfusion reaction, again, a long time ago, over 10 years ago, and we were looking at this patient who was getting a transfusion of leukocyte-reduced platelets. In doing the clerical check, we noticed something really, really odd. If you look down at the bottom left side of this little transfusion record, you'll see, and I'll blow it up for you, that this patient suffered the acute onset of hives and chills and bitching. I'm sorry, it still makes me laugh over 10 years later. Untouched, completely unretouched photo, this is exactly the way this looked, and it still makes me laugh. Obviously, this wasn't a significant reaction for her. I think they meant itching. In fact, I'm positive they meant itching, but bitching is far funnier. Okay, so again, the process, number one, stop the transfusion. Step two, perform the clerical check, make sure that the right blood has gone to the right patient, and then draw the post-transfusion sample. With that post-transfusion sample, we're gonna do three basic things. We're gonna do a check for hemoglobinemia, a direct antiglobulin test, and ABO and RH testing. And really, this will complete our screen for acute hemolysis. If everything here is negative, the patient is not having an acute hemolytic transfusion reaction. You can really pretty reliably say that if everything is negative. Let's take them one by one. First, the visible hemoglobinemia. We draw a post-transfusion sample, obviously. It's usually EDTA because you can then use the EDTA sample to do the direct antiglobulin test. Really, really great test. You just centrifuge the blood and you look for a color change in the plasma. That color change will indicate if there's as little as 2 to 5 cc's of red cells hemolyzed anywhere in the body. That's incredible. Super, super sensitive test. Unfortunately, it's not completely specific because things like poor phlebotomies, non-immune hemolysis that gives you hemoglobin or free hemoglobin, and as well as things like G6PD deficiency, same deal. Those can all give you false positives, and that's generally the issue with visible hemoglobinemia, is that it's super sensitive, but it's prone to false positives. You can also get false negatives, on the other hand, if you wait too long to draw the post-transfusion sample. In other words, if somebody ignores it, and the free hemoglobin has already been cleared by the time you draw a sample, or if you draw that sample from an IV line and dilute the blood, you can give yourself a false negative as well. So here's how it looks, and this is exactly what you don't want to see. This specimen on the right is a pre-transfusion sample from the same patient as the tube on the left, which is the post-transfusion sample. This was a young soldier that this happened a long time ago when I was in the Army at Walter Reed Army Medical Center. This guy actually had non-immune hemolysis. He did not have an acute hemolytic transfusion reaction. His blood was most likely run in the same line with half normal saline, which caused an osmotic hemolysis of his blood and gave you a very strong post-transfusion visible hemoglobin. This study, which I know is a little hard to see, it's a scan from an image that was on the cover of Transfusion back in 2003. I love this. I love what they did here. This group actually simulated how the plasma would look with as little as 2.5 or 5 mLs of hemolysis. And if you can see it, I know it's faint, on the right side of that second image there, you can see the last three tubes are 5 mLs of hemolysis, 2.5 mLs of hemolysis, and no hemolysis. And if you can see it, you can see there actually is a little bit of visible color change at 2.5, and definitely a color change at 5 mLs of hemolysis. It's a great test. Again, it's basically your desert island test. If you only have one test to determine whether or not someone is having acute intravascular hemolysis, this is the one to use. The DAT, on the other hand, is a great test as well, but it specifically is looking for the coating of red cells with antibody and/or complement that has happened in the body. In other words, unlike an indirect antiglobulin test, we're not looking for test tube coating of the red cells. We're looking for coating that's happened in the body. We usually use a polyspecific method that actually looks for coating of the red cells with either immunoglobulin, specifically IgG, or complement, specifically C3d. And important to remember that if the post-transfusion DAT is positive, you need to compare to the pre-transfusion. More on that in a second. Here's an image of a DAT from Dr. Zaradona and Yazer from the Canadian Medical Association Journal in 2006. This is a great illustration, and your handout has one that's very similar to this. If you look, let's just walk through it. On the left side, we have red cells that are coated, in this case, with antibody. But again, we usually use a reagent that looks for either antibody and or complement. Those red cells are coated. You add the anti-human globulin reagent shown here in yellow, which binds to coated red cells, because again, you note the red cells on the left are not agglutinated. That anti-human globulin will grab onto that IgG that's coating the red cells, and then in step three, you'll see that there is visible agglutination as a result. That's pretty good, and that hopefully that'll show you how it works, but I want to show you in a little different way in case it's not completely clear. A DAT basically does this. Here we have a patient who has a sea of their own red cells, as well as their own antibodies just kind of floating around in their blood. And into that milieu, we're adding a whole bunch of donor red cells. Well, what can happen? Let's show you schematically. Imagine that this big white box is the patient's blood, and in that patient's blood, you have the patient's own red cells, which are shown by having a nice, pretty yellow halo. And that yellow halo, because it's the patient's own cells, basically means that they don't interact with the patient's own antibodies. So everything's floating around here. Everybody's getting along pretty well. And into that milieu, you throw donor red cells. Well, what can happen as a result of this? In most cases, absolutely nothing. Because we do all of our work beforehand to make sure that those red cells are compatible, there usually is not an interaction with the patient's antibodies and the donor red cells. But on occasion, for a variety of reasons, either a transfusion error or an antibody that we couldn't see that is now stronger, for whatever reason, the antibody can have an interaction with the patient antibody can have an interaction with the donor's red cells, and you will get what you see here, which is a coating of those red cells, but not necessarily agglutination of the red cells. This classically happens with IgG non-ABO antibodies, where the red cells are agglutinated, or sorry, the red cells are coated, but not agglutinated. Into that mix, because we can't see this in a test tube, we throw anti-human globulin. And anti-human globulin is designed, as I said, we usually use polyspecific forms that will grab onto either antibodies, such as these pretty pink antibodies here, or complement coating red cells, and they'll do this. They'll bind to those red cells and give you a situation where you actually have visible agglutination because of an indirect process, basically. This is a direct antiglobulin test, but the agglutination is because the anti-human globulin shown in blue is binding to antibody, which is then in turn bound to red cells, and that all happened in the body, in the bloodstream. Okay, once you get a positive DAT, there's one specific question that you need to ask, and every blood banker and every blood bank physician needs to know this question, and that question is, what was the pre-transfusion DAT? It's important to compare them. If there's a significant change, then that may be indicative of that this is a potentially significant reaction. If it's exactly the same as it was before, then that doesn't really mean much. It generally doesn't mean that that this particular transfusion is likely to have caused a significant problem. The other thing to remember is that people walk around in the hospital with positive DATs in some studies as much as close to 20% of the time, and those positive DATs are completely unimportant. So don't get too hung up on someone who has a positive pre-transfusion and post-transfusion DAT. Do get worried when you have someone who has a negative pre-transfusion and suddenly has a positive post-transfusion DAT. Especially a strong one, though that's not always predictive that the reaction is more severe. It may be indicative of stronger coating of those red cells. The last thing that we do on the with our post-transfusion sample in tier one testing is we do repeat of some of our serologic tests. Especially we do a pre and post-transfusion repeat of the ABO testing and usually the RH testing as well. It's just another check to make sure that we're talking about the right patient who got the right blood. If you do find a discrepancy here, though, hugely important, remember that may be indicative that someone's blood was mislabeled, and you need to think about a companion error. In particular, if another unit of blood was drawn in the same area or another blood sample was drawn in the same area at about the same time, you could have another specimen that was mislabeled. I think of it this way. I already know that if I find a discrepancy in a situation like this and someone has acute hemolysis, I already know I'm going to have a bad day. Obviously not as bad as that patient, but it's already a bad day. So let's try and make sure we're not having a really bad day because of an additional error as a result of a companion situation where someone's tubes were mislabeled as a result of another tube being mislabeled. Okay, so if you go through all those things in your tier one tests and you find absolutely nothing, again, you can generally say we don't have acute hemolysis. And if you're in that setting, it is really important to communicate that to someone, to talk to someone. They're going to ask you questions, and that's great. They should ask you questions. They want to know things like, can I transfuse more? And in most cases, that answer is yes. That may not be true if we're talking about someone who has a severe allergic reaction, for example. It's, of course, going to depend on the etiology, but when we can rule out acute hemolysis, you can usually find a scenario under which you can transfuse someone again. They will also ask, will this happen again? And again, that depends on the etiology, and especially if we're not talking about allergic reactions. In general, most patients can receive additional transfusions, but again, it depends on exactly what's going on. Okay, so we've gone through the tier one tests. If you've done that and you see something that's you're worried about on one of your tier one tests, or if there are clinical findings that are suggestive of hemolysis, then you may need to go to the second tier testing. And that includes the tests that you see down there at the bottom, including haptoglobin, bilirubin, LDH, urine hemoglobin, and a variety of serologic tests, including cross matches and Elutes. And that's what's summarized in this slide here. Again, these are primarily looking for suspected hemolysis, the tier two tests. Again, this is my terminology. Other people call these tests different terms. That's totally fine. Different tiers, whatever. This is just how I describe them. Let's go through them one by one. First, serologic testing. Man, there's so many different serologic repeat tests that you can do. I'm just showing you a few of them here. If you take a look at the technical manual, you will definitely read about a number of other tests that you can do. But the basics would include repeating the antibody screen using, of course, the pre- and the post-transfusion samples to look and see if we missed an antibody. Consider using different enhancement. For example, if you test with tubes and you use LIS enhancement, you might want to use PEG, or you might want to consider using gel, or if you use gel, you might want to consider using solid phase, or if you use solid phase, you might want to consider using gel. You can see what I'm talking about. Consider a different enhancement or a different testing platform, and you may have to send it to another lab to get that done. Second thing to do is to consider repeating the cross-match, including both pre and post. Again, let's just make as sure as we can that we did all of our testing right and there wasn't an incompatibility that we missed. One thing I would say to you is that you might want to consider taking the next step. So in other words, if you're in a facility that uses a computer or electronic cross-match where you didn't actually do an actual, you know, blood on plasma compatibility test, you might want to do that test, such as an immediate spin ABO test. If you did an immediate spin test, then you might want to do a full cross match that includes incubation with anti-human globulin or testing with anti-human globulin, etc. Tube testing may be best for this because it offers so much flexibility, but you can certainly do it other ways as well. But the cross match is probably best done with tube testing. Okay, so what about the Elutes? People talk about Elutes all the time. I want to make sure you know what that means. So we go back to our positive DAT slide that I showed you before, where you had patient antibodies coating donor red cells. These cells would obviously have a positive DAT, but that doesn't necessarily help us. We may want to do something to get those antibodies from the red cells into a test tube so that we can then test, obviously, to see what the antibody is. Well, an Elutes basically uses a variety of techniques. It can use chemical means, it can use heat, it can use cold, different types of variations, fundamentally designed to get that antibody off the surface of the red cell and get it into a test tube where you can then go and identify what antibody is causing you the problem. Okay, so serologic testing is one thing that you can do as part of tier two testing. In addition, serum haptoglobin is something that you can do. Clinicians love serum haptoglobin. I'm not such a big fan. I love this image, however. This image is from an article in Nature in 2001 where the receptor for hemoglobin and haptoglobin was first described. That's CD163 on the surface of a reticuloendothelial cell. Well, let's take a look at how this works. So up at the top of the image, you have free hemoglobin being released from a rupturing red cell. When that free hemoglobin is released, the body really doesn't like the hemoglobin to be floating around free because it has the potential to be toxic, especially to the kidneys. It isn't always, but it has that potential. But in addition, we really want to save the iron that's associated with the hemoglobin. So haptoglobin, which you see there in yellow, is designed to cruise along and grab onto those hemoglobin molecules and take them to the reticuloendothelial system. They interact with CD163, go into a macrophage where they're broken down into some various products that we'll talk about in a sec. That process protects the kidneys, salvages the iron, and as a result, haptoglobin is actually going to be decreased in acute hemolysis. It's most decreased in acute intravascular hemolysis, where just like you see here, the red cell is just hemolyzed and starts spitting out hemoglobin in the middle of the vasculature. But it also decreases in extravascular hemolysis, where the red cell is actually broken down in the reticuloendothelial system. It is useful, but there's a couple problems. It's not a stat test, and generally its use is best for me in terms of comparing a pre-transfusion sample to a post-transfusion, immediately post-transfusion sample, to see that the haptoglobin has actually decreased. I don't think I said that before. Hugely important to remember that. Haptoglobin goes down in acute hemolysis. I may have said it. If I said it, I'll say it again. There you go. Bilirubin, on the other hand, you can follow the image on the screen, which is the same one as on the last slide, and you can see in the reticuloendothelial system, when hemoglobin is broken down, bilirubin is one of the main products. And typically it starts off as unconjugated bilirubin. Once it gets to the liver and it's conjugated, then it's called direct bilirubin. In general, we traditionally have thought of indirect bilirubin as being associated with acute intravascular hemolysis, direct bilirubin as being associated more with extravascular hemolysis. But the reality is that when you have acute hemolysis, both indirect and direct bilirubin go up. They go up fast and they come down fast. They can be back to normal within 24 hours if you have adequate liver function. So both can come and go very quickly. I don't use them typically. Again, I think that there are other methods that I can use to determine acute hemolysis just as well as bilirubin. LDH, on the other hand, let's stay with our same image. It's working for us. When a red cell is lysed, LDH isoenzymes, in particular LD1 and 2, are very abundant inside of a red cell. So they are spewed out into the circulation, and guess what you get? You get an increase in LDH. It is unfortunately very, very nonspecific, because there are so many things that can cause increases in LDH. Obviously, MIs, obviously issues with your liver, that realistically, it's not the greatest test by itself, but it's part of the overall picture. Next is urine hemoglobin. We used to do urine hemoglobin all the time. When I was a pathology resident at the hospitals where I worked, we always asked for the next voided urine after a suspected transfusion reaction. Unfortunately, urine hemoglobin or hemoglobinuria takes longer to develop than hemoglobinemia, and it's not as sensitive as hemoglobinemia. So it doesn't really tell me anything that the visible hemoglobin check in the serum or plasma does, unless I can't get the serum check done in a timely way. In other words, if it takes 24 hours before somebody finally draws one, which is unlikely but possible, it may go false negative, as I said before. Or if you can't get a good stick, then looking at looking for the color change that you see here in this image in the urine may be helpful. Again, here's a little tidbit for people, nasty people that write exam questions. Remember, red cells in the urine, or hematuria, is not the same as hemoglobinuria. Hemoglobinuria, possible sign of a transfusion reaction. Hematuria, not so much. Okay, the peripheral smear is another clue that can help point you in the right direction in terms of an intravascular versus extravascular reaction. On the top image on the right with the red arrow, you see schistocytes, which are fragmented cells that result from acute intravascular hemolysis. ABO antibodies are classic for doing this. They bind to the red cell, fix complement, blow the red cell apart, and you get fragments like this. On the other hand, extravascular hemolysis, more commonly associated with IgG antibodies that bind but don't immediately hemolyze, because they usually don't fix complement, with the blue arrow, that extravascular hemolysis typically gives you spherocytes. Okay, so we've talked about the process, and we've talked again, focusing mostly on the presence or absence of hemolysis and trying to determine whether hemolysis is there. But you may be sitting there saying, but what about the other reactions? And you're absolutely right. There are some other things that we might do as part of a workup in specific situations where we're suspicious for some other things, like a septic or respiratory or allergic reaction. Let's talk about those very briefly, because we'll go over the details of those with the individual reactions. Certainly with septic reactions, in general, we don't culture every single unit that results in a patient having a temperature increase. Some people do, and that's fine. It's probably overkill, though. But you should set some triggers in your transfusion service saying, for example, if the temperature of the patient for the patient increases over a set amount, like 102 degrees Fahrenheit, for example, or if they have a temperature increase of more than 2 degrees or sometimes 3 degrees, or if they have severe shaking, rigors, or clinical findings suspicious for septic shock, you might want to do a a septic reaction workup, which basically means culturing everything. Culture the patient, culture the product, culture all fluids. Consider the possibility that the patient is septic because of an infected line or because of just they were going to be septic anyway from whatever disease process they had going on. With respiratory reactions, this is a big topic, but at minimum, if someone is having significant respiratory findings, you want to see a chest x-ray. Think about things like ABGs and BNP levels, BNP being associated with congestive heart failure, more commonly associated with circulatory overload than with transfusion-related acute lung injury. And if you think trally, then you may do some things like those last two bullets, like the donor testing for antibodies and considering talking to the wild and crazy folks that I used to work with in Denver. To do priming studies on the neutrophils. Not many people do that, but that's something that they do very well. Allergic reactions, on the other hand, most people don't do any testing if it's a mild, simple urticarial reaction, and there usually really isn't any need to. But if there's a severe or anaphylactic reaction, then we're going to go in the direction of checking IgA levels. Again, it's not very high yield because most anaphylactic reactions are not associated with anything demonstrable, any specific reasons. But I think everyone would agree that if you're gonna test, the thing to test for in a patient with an anaphylactic type reaction is to see if they have IgA hanging around. They may carry that diagnosis, but we really need to see if their IgA levels are undetectable on a pre-transfusion sample. If they are undetectable, then that's the only time that I actually look for serum anti-IgA, the antibody, which is actually not an IgE antibody, but an IgG antibody. That's a topic for another day. Again, we only do that if there is high suspicion because the patient has an anaphylactic reaction and has a super low or undetectable serum IgA level. So that's it. That's a quick look at the basics of the transfusion reaction workup. The next time we get together, we're going to discuss the specifics of the individual transfusion reactions. As I said before, we'll break those down based on the timing of the reaction and the presence or absence of a temperature increase. And hopefully you'll see how this workup, the stuff that we've described today, fits together in the overall big picture of the specific individual transfusion reactions. So congratulations, you've made it through. You've survived part one of the Transfusion Reaction podcast. I hope that this was as fun for you listening as it was for me making it. I look forward to your comments. Please notice the disclaimer on this page. This is not a medical consultation. And note the request for asking permission before you rebroadcast at the end. So thanks again. I always appreciate you guys hanging out with me, and I hope this was useful for you. Take care. Have yourself a great day.